Good morning, everybody, and welcome to church.
And here are some things that you need to know about that are going on in and around our church.
Pastor will be starting Wednesday night Bible study and prayer at 6:30 in the fellowship room. He will no longer be hosting the Zoom meetings.
New information for SWID Ladies Day. There will be a cost of $10 per person, and the deadline to register is March 17th. The speaker will be Leanne Willis. You will receive a tote bag with snacks, goodies, and a map of the Nashville Brown County businesses. Also, many other safe facility and transportation services will be available for your convenience. Please place your name on the sign-up sheet and give your money to Debbie as soon as possible.
Breakfast and Sunday school classes for all ages will begin next Sunday, March the 7th. Breakfast served at 8:30 a.m.
The Children's Ministry Council will meet Monday, March the 8th at 6 p.m.
The Virtual Hello is a ministry to send recorded video messages to shut-ins, the sick, or the lonely. Today we will be recording messages for our dear friend Nancy Troxel. Please stop by the room at the end of the coat racks after service and record your special greeting.
Today is the last Sunday to collect alabaster offering until September. Take an alabaster brick box home and collect spare change until September.
There will be a safety team meeting in the sanctuary March the 6th from 2 to 3 p.m. in the church sanctuary.
And now it's time to worship.
Good morning. Let's stand up and worship.
This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides.
In every season. In Hebrews chapter 1, it says, in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. He became as superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Well, I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of faith were never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. And
better than you, oh, there's
Lord, we praise you for that. You're the only one who can change the things in our life. We give you control this morning, Lord. We praise you. We lift you up. Amen. You may be seated.
Tasted and seen of the sweetest stuff.
Amen. We're in our Lenten series and sacred invitation. I hope you've been reading the devotional books. There's still a couple back there that you can pick one up if you need one and join on in. We're on our way to Easter and Good Friday and the salvation and the resurrection, the things that God has provided for us. And so we're trying to, along this way through Lent, to prepare our hearts for what God wants to do. I know there's been a lot of heartache, but there's been a lot of joy in what God is doing through the heartaches. We got to keep focusing our attention on Him, don't we? Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. A lot of loss, a lot of hurt, a lot of confusion, a lot of fear, a lot of struggles. But where are you going to go? Go to Jesus. He has the words of eternal life. Eternal life. And let's lift each other up in prayer. All right, we're looking at our scripture that they gave us is Mark 3, 31, into chapter 4, verse 9, as we stand together. Mark 3. Then Jesus' brothers and his mother came, and standing outside, they sent to Jesus, calling him. And a multitude were sitting around him, and they said to him, "Look, your mother and your brothers are outside, seeking you." Jesus answered them, saying, "Who is my mother or my brothers?" And he looked around in a circle at those who sat about him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and mother." And again he began to teach by the sea, and a great multitude was gathered to him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it in the sea. And the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea, and he taught them many things by parables. And said to them in his teaching, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And it happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside. The birds of the air came and devoured it. Some fell on stony ground where it did not have much earth. And immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched. And because it had no root, it withered away. And some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. But other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased, and produced, some 30-fold, some 60, and 100. And he said to them, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Let's pray. Again, Lord, we open your word. We thank you for it. We ask that you would guide us in the next few moments, and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. David, in our Sunday school classes, adults class, has been teaching from Luke, and he talked today about the sending out of the seven. And my highlight in my Bible, the chapter paragraph heading said, "The mission of the 70." And I always worry in Sunday school class because David gets to preach and other people get to preaching back at him. And sooner or later, they get to my sermon. So doesn't always happen that way, but it sometimes happens. And they were talking about the mission of the 70. And, you know, Jesus has so much to teach us. He does. But no doubt you notice in our passage today that it combines different settings. Jesus was teaching inside a house, and Jesus was teaching from a boat, sitting in a boat, to the people standing on the shore. At the house, it said there was a multitude, and on the shore, they said it was a great multitude. Obviously, more people could fit along the shore than could crowd in and around a house, but it's just interesting. The point is that the people seem to be constantly crowding around Jesus. If you're in a house, they're packing in the house. If you're trying to teach all along by the sea, you might as well get in a boat because there's so many people that they can't all hear what you're saying. And he's done that more than once. And so we know that another occasion when they were in the house that there were so many people, they couldn't get in. So they actually tore the roof off in order to minister to a friend and let him down through the roof. And you know, this is Jesus in his early ministry. This is what was happening. Obviously, people showed up for many different reasons. There were the disciples who were called and were there to learn and minister with Jesus and learn from Jesus. There were the needy. Some of them came seeking physical touches, miracles, things like that, such as the boys who lowered their friend down, these men, so he would be healed. And there were those that were just there for the miracles. There were some who came because they were curious. He was the latest event on national TV. And so they were showing up to figure it out and to get on the camera. And so if it was happening, they wanted to be in the happening. I find it interesting that every time there's a bomb scare in Brazil, everybody shows up in the parking lot. I if there's a bomb scare, stay away. But it was in the paper. Please don't show up. Everybody gets on their Facebook and everywhere, oh, there's a bomb. And everybody goes, oh, I'm going to go see the bomb. I guess we want to get on national TV if the place blows up. I don't know. I don't understand it. People are so weird. And so there's the curious. And then there were critics and their accusers and their fault finders and that whole group that kept following Jesus around, right? So we got all these people constantly bombarding Jesus, some to find fault and some to get help and some just to, because there's a bomb scare and they're there. Now it's interesting that Jesus would choose to share the parable of a sower with such mixed crowds. And obviously different ones in there, if they would know the whole meaning of what he was sharing, would say, ah, that's me, right? But he talked in parables to be nice. And so he couldn't say, okay, the hardened soil is the Pharisees, you know, or whatever. He didn't do that. He just laid them out there and let the chips fall where they lie, and the message would hopefully penetrate. And the disciples later would ask him in this later in this chapter 4 what it meant, and he shared with them more in detail what it actually meant. But Jesus told parables to share truths in a story form. Many of them wouldn't understand the whole message, but he shared it with his disciples later, the real meaning in this case. But looking at this entire passage, because the writers to Sacred Invitation included this chapter 3 section into this chapter 4 section, so I backed up and I was thinking, why did they do that? But I think Jesus is teaching his disciples about missional priorities. And really, we know the story of the sower and the seeds. This first one, we don't preach from, perhaps, as much from the end of chapter 3. So I want to look at missional priorities. If we're going to be on a mission for God, what are some of the things we need to do? And obviously, there's more than just in this passage, but there's two or three here that we need to point out. The first one is from the end of chapter 3, where his mother and his brothers are coming to Jesus, and they send a message in because he's in there teaching and they can't get in. And he says, who are my mother and brothers? You are my mother and brothers, if you do the will of God. Interesting. So while Jesus is inside this crowded house with others listening through the open doors and windows and out in the streets, and maybe some are saying, he said this, and passing it down the chain, his brothers and his mother showed up. Now Mark seems to be drawing a sharp contrast between the groups. Jesus is inside doing ministry. His family was outside trying to get him to leave the group inside and come and join them outside. I mean, it's very particular. His brother and his mothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him, calling him. And the whole idea, the context is, leave those people and come to us. And a multitude is sitting around him, and they said to him, look, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who is my mother and brother? And he looks at the circle of those sitting around him, and he says, you are. Isn't that interesting? Here are my mothers and brothers, for whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and my mother. And some pointed out, he includes females in this, which would have been very unusual in their day. So Mark is drawing this contrast between outside and inside. All the commentators I read felt like the family were concerned about Jesus and wanted to stop his ministry. In fact, some commentators thought that they were part of the group in verse 21 of chapter 3 who physically took hold of Jesus and said, he is out of his mind. So this is not a social call the family is making. Remember, it's real early in his ministry. His family members were there to take Jesus away from his little group of followers, and they felt they needed to save Jesus from the excitement of the crowds and his own delusional teachings because they were hearing of what he was doing and they weren't liking it. It was reflecting upon them. They were not part of his ministry. They were outside, Mark is telling us, of the group trying to get Jesus to come to them and to leave his ministry behind. So how did Jesus respond? He questioned the cultural theory that blood ties are stronger than spiritual ties. Mark wrote, he looked around in a circle at those who sat around him and said, you are my true family, because my family is whoever does the will of God. He didn't respond to them. He didn't go to his family members. He said, this is my family. In other words, while I love my physical family, I love my spiritual family more. These men and women who are investing in a real relationship with God are a higher priority than blood kinships. Well, some people say that's pretty harsh. But that's the words of Jesus here. For Jesus, the men and women around him in this circle were those who identified with his mission. They were called to proclaim the good news with him. They were living in a relationship with him. It was a higher priority than those who were outside trying to stop his ministry. In Mark's contrast, the gospel, the contrast is clear. Those who thought themselves on the inside, those who had the inside track, his family members, but more than that, even the religious leaders, they thought they were on the inside of Jesus, of God's circle. They were really not. They chose to be outside his circle. But those by them who were considered to be on the outside, the sinners, the marginalized by society, the nobodies, those that were restored from terrible things such as physical illness or spiritual problems, even demon possession, those Jesus brought in to his inner circle. Wow. Think about it. Where you used to be outside, you're now inside. And sometimes those who think they ought to be inside are actually on the outside. Jesus has a way of turning everything upside down. He said, these are the ones doing the will of God. Now, this doesn't mean Jesus is not concerned about his physical family. I think the scriptures obviously point to that. But here he is drawing a contrast at the beginning of his ministry. I'm not going to stop because of my family. I've got to do what God has called me to do. I've got to follow his will. Later on, we know that his mother, he made sure on the cross that she was going to be taken care of after his death. And we also know that his brother James became the head pastor in the church in Jerusalem and maybe even wrote the book of James. I mean, so we know his family gets involved in his ministry later on. and in Christianity. Some think Jude, the writer of Jude, was also a brother of Jesus. Now, those called to ministry understand what Jesus did here. Missionaries and pastors leave family behind to follow God's will. I remember when my brother left. I was there the day they drove out and headed towards Mexico. And we didn't hear again from them in a long time. Days before cell phones and internet and etc., we didn't know if they were dead or alive. Sometimes for months. There's something about family ties having to be surrendered to lordship ties and call ties and ministry ties. I was thinking of our pastor, you know, my dad was a pastor and kept moving around and anyway. Jesus taught in Mark chapter 10. Peter's complaining a little bit, a little homesickness maybe, I don't know. He said to Jesus, "See, we have left all to follow you." In Mark 10:29, Jesus answered and said, "Assuredly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's, who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. For many who are first will be last, last will be first." I mean, those are the words of Jesus again. So it's obviously, it's not about family first. It's about following Jesus first. Amen? We have even heard accounts of those who became Christians who were disowned by their families. Some who became Christians, the family actually held a funeral. If you're going to take that route, you're done. As far as we're concerned. The choice to follow Jesus meant they needed a new family, and God provided one for them. He'll give you brothers and sisters, Jesus said, and eternal life. So I want to ask you, who is in your inner circle? It's an important question. There's nothing wrong with strong family connections, but what if they don't support your beliefs? What if they're not supporting your moral values? What if they don't go with your choices? What if they don't support you in your ministry that God has called you to do? Many in my family are Christians. But other than Debbie, they are really not in my inner circle. My Christian family for years has been church people where I pastor. That's become my family. You guys have been stuck with me for 6 years and a little bit more. And some of you, you're hard to get along with. You're family. I gotta love you anyway. I'm being fun, but it's the truth. I'm closer to people here than I am with my actual blood kin. Because you support me, encourage me in my ministry. And I have inner circles within the church family. And because of COVID, it's really gotten down to one. The inner circle. For me, this last year has been my men's prayer group. That's my inner circle. Because they choose to share with me in prayer. They pray for my daughters by name. They pray for my concerns. They pray for this service. They pray for the presence of God. I know their family members and their requests. I pray for them by name. They pray their, for my prayer needs and others in the room, and we pray for each other's prayer. You can't pray for each other and get involved in each other's prayer requests and the inter-sanction of each other's lives without becoming part of an inner circle. And it's so important. We're in this journey together. The men's prayer group has been, before that, I also had Wednesday night prayer group where we get together and share stuff and you get to know each other a little bit better. And sometimes the Sunday school class, you can do that, but a lot of times they're bigger. And you get a circle going where you share together. I'm hoping that the praise team is a circle of inner circle. You share stuff with each other. You pray for each other. And I'm hoping that there's other groups like that where it doesn't matter about the family connection. It's about your Jesus connection. If you care enough to call on a person and say, pray with me. I'm burdened. I'm hurt. I need help. There are people in your life who want to do God's will. It's their first and most important priority. And when you have a need, you want those people, right? That's your circle. Who do you think about? It's sad to say there's some Christians who solo it. But we need the circle. Amen. And that helps you through life. I know there's the church family, and that's certainly a big circle. But sometimes you just need that inner group. And I think of our missional priorities is, who do you do life with? Who do you share your secrets with? Besides Jesus, who is it? And it's more than just BFFs and all that kind of stuff. It is the intimacy of knowledge of sharing with the important issues of your life with people you can trust. And that is what makes ministry possible, because that is the center, your focus, the people that are in the trenches with you, the people that are supporting you, the people that are helping you. And I'm laying this really strong here because it's never preached. Jesus said to his own family, don't have time for you right now. I've got to do what God has called me to do. I've got to follow his will. This is his ministry for me, he said, right here. Wow. Choose your inner circle. The second missional priority, which we know, is invest most in those who produce. We're jumping down then to the parable of the sower, which has been renamed by many as the parable of the soils, because they think the emphasis Jesus is making is about people's receptivity to the word. I mean, who is receptive and who's not? Right? And we know the different ones, the four types. There's the wayside. It's the hard-packed earth. Besides the farmer, the farmer's in his field, but beside the field, people have to walk. And so they're walking on it, and they stomp it down. And so if you throw seed out there, it's not going to penetrate because it's hard. It's wayside, they call it. Or the seed doesn't penetrate, and it even says that the birds will come along and eat it. And then Jesus, when he tells his disciples what that means, he says, it's Satan. You're throwing seed out to some people. They're so hardened. And Satan makes sure it doesn't do anything. He grabs it before the seed can even begin to penetrate. So these are people hardened by sin. If any gospel comes their way, Satan makes sure it doesn't take root. The stony ground is shallow soil over a bed of rocks. A rock, So there's a little thin, so the seed hits there, the rocks are warm, it generates real quickly, but there's nowhere for the roots to go, nothing happens, the sun comes out, and the thing just withers. And this represents people with an emotional stirring for God, but no commitment to change, no commitment to grow. You've seen these kind of people? Yes, I want God. Yes, I do. But when God lays his finger, they say, uh-uh. The thorns soak up all the soil nutrients from the good seed. They say some farmers don't clean their fields very good before they plant. So these thorns are coming up. Well, the good seed tries to come up amongst them. And so all the, why is it that the things you don't like in your garden suck out all the nutrients and whatever from the things that you do want to eat, you know. So that's why you have to get out there and weed and so on. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. But they start out as Christians, but other priorities are more important than the spiritual. And it could be anything. It could be other people they choose over God. Other things they choose over worship. Other things that we've talked about, some of the things that you need in your life, but it could be the problems. Just problems just make them discouraged and they quit. I mean, that's their priority. It could be habits. It could be their possessions. It's like Jesus said when he said, "Come follow me," and he says, "Well, I got a yoke of oxen. I got to go take care of that, or I got a ground. I got to go see that, or I got a dad that I got to bury." And he says, "Let the dead bury the dead." You know, he's saying, "Where's your priorities?" And we let other things. He says, "Son of man has nowhere to lay his head. You're not going to follow me. You don't understand what this is about. It's about leaving things behind and following Jesus." And they have other priorities. And so these priorities choke out their time, their energies, their resources, leaving nothing left for spiritual growth. And sooner or later, what happened to so-and-so? Well, so Jesus is pointing this out. And then he talks about the good ground, a soil that actually produces a crop. And it produces more seed for future sowings, for other crops. He says it not only grows, but it produces. And these are Christians who grow in Christ and then begin to invest time and energy in ministry so others can hear about Jesus and accept him and in turn grow and produce for him. These are the producers. It's no good for a crop to grow and have beautiful leaves. It needs to produce, or it's not doing anything. There's nothing to eat. There's nothing to feed on. There's nothing that will grow for another generation. So in this parable, the problem is not with the sower. The problem is not with the seed. Nothing wrong with the seed. There's nothing wrong with the sower. The problem is with the quality of the soils, the reception of the soil, the reception of the person, the spiritual condition. In order to produce, there has to be spiritual change, a spiritual desire, a spiritual receptivity. So it is important that when we begin to share God's word, and we should be doing it, that we prioritize our ministry to those who are most likely to accept Jesus, grow in Jesus, and produce for Jesus. There's a priority here, Jesus is saying. Invest most in those who will produce. Amen? But there's one more missional priority. And I just want to say, you know, people don't like it. But there comes time when you just have to say, I got to do my ministry. If you're raising children in a Christian home, that is a primary investment of ministry. Amen? Who else has them but you? You are their focus. I mean, you've got to pour into their lives. Because they ain't getting it out there. Just a thought. So parents, we need to hold them up because their investment is a lot of it's right there in the house. Read God's word, pray, share. How do you hold your emotions? How do you deal with problems in life? Well, let's pray about them. Let's gather in as a family. Let's deal with this. Let's make this decision. How would God, right? Okay. But there's other things in life. I mean, there's people you work with. Some of them are wayside, some are thorns, some are rocky soil, some have good ground. Choose where you're going to invest the most of your ministry. But I don't want us to stop there because there's an interesting thought that comes out of this, which is point number three. Invest most in those who produce, but he also said share truth to anyone around you. Okay? And you thought, well, he's going to stick there. No, this is the other side of the whole ministry thing. All right? Because while the sower cares and the farmer puts most attention on the most productive soil, I mean, he's going to make sure that he gets the seed so he can have a crop, right? But what did this sower do? What does Jesus do? What do? We continue to scatter seed, even if it's not always good soil. The seed has to go out. The message has to get out there. What if the rain had softened that hardened soil and a seed actually gets in there before Satan comes and snatches it away? What if? Right? Well, I concentrate only on good Christian people. Well, that's not what the sower did. It scattered. So some of it went among the thorns, and some of it went on the wayside, and some of it went on the shallow soil. Some of it went where it probably won't produce, but most of the time it went to the good ground, but he did still scatter the seed to everyone. How many times did the gospel seed come your way before you actually were good enough soil to accept it and let it germinate and let it happen? How long were you the wayside? How long were you the shallowness? How long were you with mixed priorities with the thorn? How long were you stuck in a different pathway? And what if they would have stopped throwing seed your way? Amen, I'm talking church. How many chances did you get? Aren't you glad they threw a little more seed your way? I mean, this is practical stuff here. Yes, put all your investment that you possibly can in the good soil because that's what produces. But also, don't forget, here's some for you. We're on the parade and you're throwing the candy out, you know? Everyone needs some seed. You did. And the good news is to think about is there's not a shortage of seed. Is there a shortage? Has Jesus run out yet? Has preachers run out of things to say? As you, as a mother, you run out of things to say? Is there something good that you can teach and share, broadcast, post? If there was a shortage of seed, then would we be very picky on where we shared it? Because then we'd want the most productive soils to get the little bit of seed we had. But this guy, the sower, you and I, Jesus, when we go out there, right? Make sure you cover the good ground, but if a few falls on the other side, and a few falls over here, a few falls, it's okay. So while you're teaching that one person at work who's really going through the struggle, and you're getting in the yoke with them, and you're leading them through that mire and out and pulling their load and helping them with it, you're also, other people are seeing it, and they're going, "Well, look at her." See, you're scattering some seed to them as well, because they're going to see how you act and see how Jesus cares. Regardless of the possible waste, and how many times was seed wasted on me and you? Regardless of that possible waste, the sower continues to throw seed. He is generous in sharing. She is generous in giving and caring. And as a result, you throw enough seed, you're going to get a good harvest. In spite of what maybe seems is wasted. You think your prayers are wasted? You think the good news is wasted? So while we invest most in our ministry efforts on people ready to grow and ready to reproduce for God, we still must represent Jesus to those who have refused him before. Because the hardness and the shallowness or the thorniness of people should not deter us from God's intent, is that all should hear. Amen. It's called prevenient grace, ladies and gentlemen. The grace that goes before we become a Christian. It's that grace that is scattered on the wayside. It's that grace that God gives to those who are shallow. And then the grace to those who have so many other priorities, they have no time for God. But I tell you, crisis can knock them down. A seed can penetrate. You don't know when it will happen. And God in his prevenient grace had you there throwing some seed out in your neighborhood, in your place of work, down at the IGA, which is gone now. It's a Walmart or Kroger's. And he has you doing that in the drive-through line. When everybody else is grumping and complaining, you come along and say, "You know what, God bless you, have a good day." Amen. Prevenient grace, because his spirit is still out there drawing people. And the problems of life cause people to open up. We never know, but that sometime later, God's word is going to begin to grow and begin to produce in that person's heart and life. Just like it took you a while. So God wants everyone to be part of his kingdom, and he has chosen you to share the truth, his truth, to those around you. Your job is not Greencastle, unless you work there. Your job is Brazil. Your family, your friends, your associates, your neighbors, or whoever God lays on your heart. That's us. Amen. So what are missional priorities of Christians according to Jesus here? You need to start by getting that group of people around you who share your burdens and your concerns and your mission and who are doing the will of God. He said, those who are doing the will of God are my brothers and sisters and mother. Make them part of your inner circle. If you don't have one, get one. There's got to be enough people around here that are as weird as you that you can begin to share with and tie in with and make them your group. Amen. How important is that? Who's going to pull you up? Who's going to surround you with love? Who's going to listen to your faults and failures and say, "You know what? God gave me another chance. Let's pray and God will give you another chance." Amen. We need it. So that's a priority, because you can't do ministry and mission without having somebody with you. Why you send them out two by two? All right. But your group can be bigger than two. Jesus had up to 12. And even one of them failed him. So some of your group may change. All right. Get that inner circle going who are doing the will of God. Second, invest most of your efforts in those who will grow and produce. That makes sense. Third, also share God's truth with anyone around you. Because you never know when someone is ready to begin that deeper life with God. All right. In this season called Lent, it's good to rethink our priorities. And I just want to ask you, where does God fit into your busy life? You've had so much more time since COVID hit. So much more time to read the newspaper from cover to cover, and so much more time to watch news 24/7 so you know immediately the moment something happens. And to monitor your Facebook 24/7 so if there is a bomb scare down at Kroger's, you will be there to blow up with everyone else. Where are we investing our time? In our busy lives, how are we loving God? How are you loving Him? During Lent, we're thinking about how can I show God how much I love Him because He loved me so much. There's the cross. And how are you investing in God's work and in His kingdom? These are priorities we need to be looking at. What if you get the phone call that says, I'm ready to accept Jesus? Can you do it? So as we come before the Lord this morning, talk to Him. This is you and God time, right? And share with Him what's going on. What's going on? He already knows. And sometimes you might want somebody with you, part of your circle. That's okay. But it's talk to Jesus about our priorities. I think Sunday, being the first of the week, is a good time for us to think about our priorities for the week. What is God going to do in my life this week? All right. So as praise team comes and leads us in a song, and just open it up and we'll stand together and we will worship Him as well as talk to Him now at family altar time. Lord, we just bow before You and say, this is Your moment to move, and You're already moving. So it's our moment to move. That's what I should have said. It's our moment to begin to move as God is calling us and speaking to us today. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. And some of us may have some soil problems ourselves. We may be a little hardened. Maybe we're too shallow. Maybe we have the wrong priorities. And You're calling us to be good ground today. So You know what You're doing in each life. Every life is different. Some of us may not be casting enough seed. Some of us may be wasting it and need to reprioritize on specific ministries You've called us to do. I don't know where it's at. Some of us may need an inner circle. And so, Lord, would You guide us in this? Help us to pray about these things. Because You, Lord, want to improve us. You love us so much, You always want to improve us. We thank You for that. In Jesus' name. Yeah, let's find the Lord. Stand as we have family altar time. Thank you. Jesus, there's so much heartache in this world. There's so much hurt. That's why we need Jesus. That's why we need a cross. That's why we need an empty tomb today. To know because he lives, we can face tomorrow. To know that Jesus died and rose again so that we can take another day, another step. We do lift up those who are grieving today and pray in a special way that you would somehow love them and somehow let them know it's okay, God's going to take care of it. We pray for those recovering from surgery today to know that God has given them another chance and that, Lord, they would just somehow step out and heal and be better and grow. We pray, Lord, for work associates, for neighbors, for family members who are struggling with their relationship with God. I just pray, Lord, that somehow allow our smiles and our prayers and our compassion and concern be Jesus flowing through us to them during this time of need. And Lord, in a world that is, seems like our United States is just running as fast as it can in the opposite direction away from God in so many areas, Lord, will you somehow slow this down? Lord, will you somehow bring some reality back into leaders' minds and hearts? But Lord, then we want to focus on Brazil and right around here because, Lord, right here, we have enough mess. The arrest for drugs and other things and here in our own community. Children that are growing up and going to the school next door who don't even know who Jesus is. Lord, we have plenty to do right here. Lord, you're the one who loves us. Every one of us. Everyone. You love those who are grieving. You love those who are hurting. You love those that are healing. You love those, Lord, that are struggling. You love those, Lord, who are questioning. You love those that are bargaining. You love those, Lord, that are angry. You love those that are frustrated. You love them all. You died for them all. Lord, you're so wonderful. You're so compassionate. And Lord, I just don't do an adequate enough job sharing that love to others. Lord, I pray that you'll help all of us just to take a step, just a step forward to become more compassionate and more loving and more caring because the hurting are there. Help us to shine the light of Jesus to those that need him most. Help us to pray for those that need him. And help us, Lord, to be Jesus to them as best we can as we sow our seed. We're not Jesus. We know that. We're not perfect. But Lord, use what you can of us to make an impact on the world around us. And we ask this and offer ourselves to this in Jesus' name. So we pray especially for Sarah today. Pray especially for the Philobom family today and the Green family. We pray for the Brown family today. And we pray, Lord, there's so many. Lord, we just lift them up to you. Ask that somehow the compassion of Jesus Christ will flow. Be with that lonely one right now who's a Christian, is tucked away in a nursing home or somewhere. Can you be their friend, Lord Jesus? Lord Jesus, help them, we pray. Well, there's so many things to pray about, but Lord, it's time to worship you. And so we just ask that you would guide us in the next few moments, lift our spirits, encourage our hearts, help us to leave this sanctuary knowing that God is has revamped us and helped us and encouraged us and filled us up so that we can share the good news. And Lord, we pray that you will be with everyone here today to take one step closer to God. Amen. We believe that, Lord. You're drawing us, and we are being encouraged by it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you.
You may be seated.
So I'm about to do a song for a special that was requested. And for a guy who prides himself on memorization, I did not memorize the song. So I have the lyrics up here. But yeah, there are a lot of lyrics, and I pray that you guys listen, and it's a powerful song.
Are you disappointed? You desperate for help? You know what it's like to be tired and only a shell of yourself. Well, you start to believe you don't have what it takes, because it's all you can do just to move, much less finish the race. But don't forget what lies ahead. Almost home, brother, it won't be long. Soon all your burdens will be gone. With all your strength, sister, run wild. But we win in the end, simply because of Jesus in us. It's not if, but when. So take joy in the journey, even when it feels long. Go find strength in each step, knowing heaven is cheering you on. Heaven to us, make no mistake, there's still more to come. When our flesh and our bones are no longer between where we are right now and where we're meant to be, when all that's been lost is made whole again, when these tears and this pain no longer exist, no more walking, we're running as fast as we can. Consider this our second wind.
Are there any announcements? All right, with that, if everybody would like to stand, we'll get the praise team back up here and finish this out. I'm ready for the next one. Do it. Let's do it.
Yeah.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes. I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes. I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. With my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with glory, Lord of night. I feel alive with you. In your presence now, I come alive. I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, I will praise you, Lord. Sorrow comes my way, you are the shield around me. Always you remain, my courage in the fight. I hear you call my name, Jesus, I am coming. Walking on the waves, reaching for your life. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy.
Good week, everybody.